Good morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ. God has awakened us to another bright new day with all its opportunities for pleasing Him. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our morning prayer begins on page 32 of our Books of Common Prayer with our opening sentence and continues on page 35 and following.
What are you doing for the King? Have you really given everything for the one who gave his all for you? Don't you be satisfied just to know that the Lord has saved.
Take up your cross and follow Jesus. Take up your cross every day. Don't be ashamed.
Let me hear of your loving kindness in the morning, for I put my trust in you. Show me the road that I must walk, for I lift up my soul to you. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. And so we pray together, Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Subenite. O come, let us sing out to the Lord. Let us shout in triumph to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his face with thanksgiving and cry out to him joyfully in psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the peaks of the mountains are his also. The sea is his and he made it. His hands molded dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he himself is our God. We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. If only you would hear his voice today, for he comes to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And now we come to this point where we have this opportunity to make ourselves right with God. To bring before God those things of which our consciences are afraid and to ask for God's forgiveness. And so let us take a moment of silence as we bring before God those things that we need to confess. And so let us pray together. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now we come to our psalm, and our psalm this morning is Psalm 18, and we turn to page 486 for Psalm 18, verses 1 to 20. Recite the psalm together. I love you, O Lord, my strength, O Lord, my stronghold, my crag, and my haven. My God, my rock in whom I put my trust, my shield, the horn of my salvation, and my refuge. You are worthy of praise. I will call upon the Lord, and so shall I be saved from my enemies. The breakers of death rolled over me. The torrents of oblivion made me afraid. The cords of hell entangled me, and the snares of death were set for me. I called upon the Lord in my distress and cried out to my God for help. He heard my voice from his heavenly dwelling. My cry of anguish came to his ears. The earth reeled and rocked. The roots of the mountains shook. They reeled because of his anger. Smoke rose from his nostrils and a consuming fire out of his mouth. Hot burning coals blazed forth from him. He parted the heavens and came down with a storm cloud under his feet. He mounted on cherubim and flew. He swooped on the wings of the wind. He wrapped darkness about him. He made dark waters and thick clouds his pavilion. From the brightness of his presence through the clouds burst hailstones and coals of fire. The Lord thundered out of heaven. The Most High uttered his voice. He loosed his arrows and scattered them. He hurled thunderbolts and routed them. The beds of the seas were uncovered, and the foundations of the world laid bare. At your battle cry, O Lord, at the blast of the breath of your nostrils, he reached down from on high and grasped me. He drew me out of great waters. He delivered me from my strong enemies and from those who hated me, for they were too mighty for me. They confronted me in the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into an open place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Now we will come to our first reading. And our first reading is from the book of Jonah. And our reading from Jonah is from chapter... Let's just find it here for a moment. It's from chapter 3, verse 1, to the end of chapter 4. We're reading from Jonah, and we're reading chapter 3, verse 1, to the end of chapter 4. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God, they proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry mightily to God. All shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger so that we do not perish. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about a bush? And he said, yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you are concerned about a bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? This is the end of the reading. Thanks be to God. And so we turn now to our canticle, and the canticle that we will do this morning is on page 54, the Song of Christ's Glory. Christ Jesus was in the form of God, but he did not cling to equality with God. He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, and was born in the likeness of men. Being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Now we come our second reading, which is from the Gospel of Luke, and we are reading from Luke chapter 9, verses 18 to 27. Luke 9, verses 18 to 27. Once when Jesus was praying alone, with only the disciples near him, he asked them, "Who do the crowd say that I am?" They answered, "John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others, that one of the ancient prophets has arisen." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered, "The Messiah of God." He sternly ordered and commanded them not to tell anyone, saying, "The Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised." Then he said to them all, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will save it. What does it profit them if they gain the whole world but lose or forfeit themselves? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words, of them the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. But truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God." This is the end of the reading. Thanks be to God.
Sometimes it feels like you can't go on, but you can make it. You just take up your cross.
So let us reflect now on this passage that we just read from Luke chapter 9, verses 18 to 27. We've come to this point where Jesus is asking his disciples, "Who do people say that I am? Who are the people saying that I am? But in particular, who do you say that I am?" And we are told that Peter gave the right answer. And in other places, it suggests to us that Peter really was inspired by God. He didn't quite know what he was saying. He didn't quite understand what he was saying. But Peter answered correctly. He gave the right answer, even though he didn't quite understand. "Who do you say that I am?" Peter answered, "The Messiah of God." You are the very Messiah of God. So Peter gave the right answer. What does he truly understand? He certainly, when we read the text as we continue, this particular text and elsewhere, we realize that Peter truly doesn't understand what the Messiahship is all about. It entails, you know, Jesus humbling himself, Jesus emptying himself, Jesus prepared to give his life, to suffer at the hands of men, human beings, and then to die, to suffer death. And we know the kind of death he suffered. So he came, Jesus consented to come to earth to undergo this kind of humiliation and death before, of course, for our sake. Because he was doing it so that we human beings might, in the end, by faith, receive forgiveness of our sins. We needed that sacrifice of the one without sin, so that our sin may be forgiven. So Jesus came, humbled himself, took on a lowly human form, underwent all, you know, the suffering, you know, all the humiliation, you know, put himself through all of this for our sake, at the will of the Father. He came to humble himself and to suffer death before, you know, of course, he's eventually being elevated. So the point about it, as we continue to read, Jesus will undergo all this. And the thing about it is, Jesus is saying to them, if any of you, you know, you want to be my followers, you call yourself my followers, now what will happen is that you will find yourself also having to take on, you know, the same kind of, you know, hardships. I shouldn't say the same kind of hardships, but you too will undergo hardships. You too will have to suffer, you know, for that role that you are to play. If you want to be my disciples, you want to follow me, literally follow me, you will in fact follow in all the things that will happen to me in terms of, you know, the suffering, in some cases even death, you know, all the negative consequences. You will suffer them. The authorities will persecute you as well. You'll be put in jail. All kinds of things will happen. You will have to deny yourself. If you want to be, you'll have to literally follow me. You know, deny yourselves. You have to take up your cross daily and follow me. So it wouldn't be, there wouldn't be a day where you would be, if you're truly reflecting me in your lives, following me as my disciples, you will have to undergo on a daily basis all kinds of hardships and suffering, you know, negative attitudes and negative consequences. Just as I would ultimately suffer death, suffering and death, you too will, some will actually suffer death, but all will have negative consequences. All will have pain and hardships and suffering because you would be seeking to serve me. And you get the same negative consequences. So you're calling, Jesus is saying to his disciples and to us today, is to deny ourselves. What does it mean, deny ourselves? Because all of us want to be popular. All of us want to be recognized by the, you know, our peers, our communities. We want that. You know, we don't want to undergo, put in jail and have people, you know, discriminate against us, have people, you know, hurl insults at us, have people look down upon us, you know, in extreme cases, in some places, being put in jail and all that, and be beaten, the negative consequences. Sometimes just being, the lack of recognition and the opprobrium or the hate directed against us. For some of us, it will be worse than even being put in jail, because we all want this recognition. But if we truly want to follow Jesus as his disciples, Jesus says we'll find having to deny ourselves the things that we really want, the recognition of our community. We'll have to deny ourselves that. The recognition, not only recognition, but other things, other aspects of our lives too. Maybe we'll be denied the right kinds of jobs, the job that we would like to have. You know, so in many ways, as we seek to stand up for what is right, as we follow Jesus, that's what following means. It means doing the things, that making the decisions that he would make, the decisions that are pleasing in his sight, that will not be pleasing to others who might be in positions of influence and authority, in positions where they can withhold from us some of the benefits that we would like to have. It might be in the way we stand up for others and for what is right in the workplace. All kinds of corruption might be going on there. But we stand against that, and we will face those consequences of our friends in inverted commas and of those in positions of authority. So as we seek to follow Jesus, to do what is right, to stand with the oppressed, you know, we will find ourselves treated in the same way that Jesus was treated, with all the negative consequences. But Jesus is saying we will have to take up our cross, you know, bear the suffering, the burdens, the hardships, the sacrifices of serving him and following him. You know, that those are the consequences. We'll have to take up our cross, figuratively speaking, and in the same way as he had to take it up and physically and otherwise pay the price, so we will have to pay the price. Not necessarily physically, but we pay the price in terms of recognition and other benefits that we as human beings in our society might like to have. We'll have to prepare to give up friendships sometimes, you know, material benefits, because we must deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow. We have to make the sacrifices. Of course, we don't think as Christians, we don't often think about this. You know, we just go along, you know. But we, if we make the right decisions at each stage, whether it's at work, whether it's in our community, in our relationships, we may be in public life in some way serving. If we make the right decisions, we always find ourselves, you know, having to stand against those who are in positions, those who are powerful, even our friends. We have to stand against often what others will want to do, which will not be in the best interest of the community. It might serve them well, but not in the best interest of the community. It may be action that discriminate or hurt others, and we won't be standing for that. So we will be making the kind of decisions that always puts us, you know, against those who might be more powerful and more influential than we are. So it means Jesus is saying we have to take up our cross. It means, you know, our burdens and our hardships, and make those sacrifices. As Christians, we, you know, too often we tend to compromise, but we do remember we have to stand up for what is good, what is right, what is in the best interest of others, which is not actions that are not oppressive against others. We cannot be supporting the kinds of actions that bring harm and hurt. And as we stand against those powerful people and influential people, even friends, sometimes we will be unpopular, we might be excluded, we might suffer material loss and other loss of friendship as well. But that is what we are called to do. We have to bear the consequences. As we stand against the powerful who seek to oppress the lowly and the needy and make decisions that are not in the best interest of the whole. So following Jesus and being true to his teaching and example will bring consequences for us from those who are in positions of power and authority. And as I said, even friends, we may find ourselves, you know, having to stand against friends because they are not standing for what we know is good and right for everyone. So true discipleship is not a life of ease, you know, by any means. After all, as disciples of Jesus, we see what he went through. Not that we will necessarily go through, of course, we will not hardly go through what Jesus had to go through to give his life. Of course, we know when we look at the history of the church, and even today in some parts of the world, Christians are actually paying with their life as they stand up for their faith. So, this passage this morning reminds us that, you know, some people join the church, or some churches, because it gives them, they see it as a way of moving up, you know, be getting some kind of recognition because they belong to a particular church. You know, they're looking for benefits. But that is not what Jesus is talking about. Jesus is saying that as true disciples, there will be times, there will at least be some times when we have to make a stand against what is not right. We will be in those situations and we must make the right decisions to stand for what is, you know, what is good, what is right, what is fair to others. We cannot stand with the discrimination that might be exerted against others. We have to stand for what is good and right. We have to stand for fair treatment of others. And we should be prepared to oppose actions that bring pain and humiliation and separation and even hurt to others. That is the way it is. So disciples of Jesus literally follow him in taking the stand against evil and facing the consequences. So may God, may we have that courage, you know, the courage of our faith to stand on the side of what is right and fair and honest and good and true, and not stand on the side of just being popular and being afraid of facing the consequences that might follow, you know, even from friends, because we might find ourselves isolated. You know, we will find ourselves suddenly with nobody talking to us, nobody paying attention to us. We might find ourselves losing. Perhaps we made an unpopular decision and we find ourselves losing perhaps benefit, losing our jobs, losing the position that we had. So the Christian life is, you know, as we live it faithfully, there are times when we make decisions which will be, will have negative consequences for us. And that is a measure of, you know, our true faith. We have to follow. There are times when we have to bear the consequences and to suffer for our faith. And indeed, Jesus' example, you know, is what we follow. You know, we do what is right, and Jesus is trying to tell us here that if you want to really be my follower, deny yourself, take up your cross daily and follow me. That is the attitude that we must have. The Lord be with you.
Take up your cross and follow Jesus.
He's gonna be
there.
Oh, yes, he is.
Every day.
Every day.
Don't be ashamed to say that you know.
We continue with the Apostles' Creed on page 42 of our Books of Common Prayer. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we continue with the prayer that our Savior has taught us. O Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We come now to our collect for today. And so we turn to page 179 for the collect for proper 23. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, that we may continually be given to good works. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue in prayer. We turn to page 45 of our Books of Common Prayer. O God, the lover of unity and the author of peace, to know you is eternal life, to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your servants, from all assaults of the enemy, that we may trust in your defense and not fear the power of any adversary. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the rest of the past night and for the gift of a new day with its opportunities of pleasing you. Grant that we may so pass its hours in the perfect freedom of your service, that at evening we may again give you thanks. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we continue in prayer as we pray for people in every part of God's world, especially as we lift up this morning those who have to live their daily lives in danger, where there's war and fighting and death and destruction in the Middle East, between Ukraine and Russia and other places, for people who are living with scarcity of food and starvation, where just to survive a given day is a burden. We pray for those who live under oppressive regimes, where there's oppression, for people living in all kinds of unfavorable conditions, where there are natural disasters. We think of the people in parts of Florida, where there was that storm, or the destruction that was caused, for people who have experienced all kinds of negatives. We pray for them at this time. We pray for courage and strength. Father, we pray for your people in the midst of all those situations of need, that all your people will shine as true lights, be sources of encouragement and help and hope. We continue to pray for your church worldwide, for all ministers of your word and sacrament, that they will be fitfully living out their calling, Lord, wherever they are found. Be sources of inspiration to your people. We continue to pray for the Anglican Communion worldwide, for all the provinces in our communion, and for all the primates of all these provinces. We pray for the Most Reverend Justin Welby, Archbishop of Canterbury. In our own province, the Church in the Province of the West Indies, we pray for Howard, our Archbishop. We pray for your hand of blessing upon him and his loved ones. We pray for your guidance and inspiration as he leads our province at this stage. And we lift up all the bishops of our dioceses in this province. your hand of power and wisdom and grace be upon them. We pray especially for our own Diocese of Trinidad and Tobago, for Bishop Claude, for all our clergy in the various parishes, as they seek to lead your people, Lord, in that way of love and service in their own lives and in the lives of others. Continue to bless and inspire your church and the entire Christian church in this land of ours. We pray for unity and that sense of togetherness in this land of ours. We lift up those you have appointed, Lord, to rule over us, our president, our prime minister, members of parliament, ministers of government, all in positions of decision-making, public trust, whose work and decisions affect the lives of our people. We pray for your inspiration upon them, your guidance, that they'll have a sense, Lord, of the importance of everything they do, and will seek to make those decisions that are in the best interest of all. We pray for the families of our nation, the homes in which our people live, for your presence with them, for your guidance and inspiration of parents as they seek to bring their children up in the way that they ought to go. We pray for the children in our homes. Touch their hearts and minds. Give them the wisdom beyond their years so that they will be able to discern good from evil and make the right choices in their lives. For all those who work with our young people, as teachers, as coaches, as other influences in their lives, we pray that these adults will seek to bring out the best in our children. And so, Lord, we pray that you will give our children wisdom to make the right choices. For those who are growing up in the midst of situations where they are being misled into lives of crime, into lives that squander the gifts that God has given them. Father, we pray for them in particular, for wisdom greater than their years, that they will make the right choices. We continue to pray for families that are in need this morning. Parents who do not know where their next meal, how they will provide their next meal for their children, how they will send them to school, how they will look after them this day. Father, we pray for your help. We pray you open our eyes and our hearts that we would discern where the needs are, and we would seek to help as much as we are able. We pray for our senior citizens who need, again, our help and support. Open our eyes that we might see, and our hearts that we would respond. For people in all kinds of need today, Lord, those who are sick and are crying out for healing, those who have lost loved ones, Lord, at this time and are saddened by their passing, give them your consolation. Those who have suffered all kinds of loss, some have lost their jobs, some have lost their relationships, family relationships have been broken. People in all kinds of need, we ask you, Lord, to be present, to speak into their hearts, give them the wisdom that they will make the choices that will be best for them. Send them the help that they need, and help them to recognize the help that they need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue the prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, may the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.